Hello, friends. Welcome to hell. Nope, that's not a good way to start. Ken Ham. Frankly, that's not much better. Right. I'm Nugget of Potato, Nugget to my friends, and welcome to this. Let's dive right in. Kenneth Alfred Ham was born in 1951 in Queensland, Australia. He got a bachelor's degree in applied science with an emphasis on environmental biology, which is ironic given his stance on climate change, from the Queensland Institute of Technology and has a diploma in education from the University of Queensland. He graduated in 1975 and began teaching at a high school in Queensland. In 1977, he started teaching in Brisbane. While common sense says, oh, he has a degree in sciencey things, he believes in things commonly believed about science. Reality often lacks common sense. Ken has always, it seems, believed in young earth creationism. This says that the book of Genesis, the first book in the Christian Bible, is historical fact. You heard me right. That the earth and the universe at large are only about 6,000 years old, that God literally created everything in 6 literal days, and his favorite refute of the Big Bang theory and evolution is, were you there? Because all of this requires observation in order to be real science. Ignore the fact that, even according to the young earth theory, humans didn't witness creation. The Bible is now the ultimate authority on science and history, according to him. In 1979, Ham resigned from teaching and founded Creation Science Supplies and Creation Science Educational Media Services. These gave Queensland, quote, resources for the teaching of creationism in public schools, end quote. In 1980, his organizations were merged with Carl Weiland's, I don't know how to pronounce his name, Creation Science Foundation. In 1987, Ken Ham moved to the United States because he wanted to spread his views there as well. He partnered with the Institute for Creation Research to do this. In 1994, he left ICR to co-found Creation Ministries International, then changed his part of the organization's name to Answers in Genesis in 1997, the headquarters of which were in Florence, Kentucky. Not only is he the founder of Answers in Genesis, which he abbreviates with a capital A, lowercase I, and a capital G, he is also the CEO. With AIG, he made the Creation Museum in Petersburg, Kentucky, which opened in 2007, and the Ark Encounter in Grant County, which opened in 2016. He chose these locations for his headquarters and museums, which he is working on expanding, because, quote, we are within 1 hour's flight of 67% of America's population. Isn't that fun? Even though I grew up evangelical, I hadn't heard of Ken Ham, or at least I didn't remember hearing about him, until his debate with Bill Nye in 2014. I've of course been a fan of Bill Nye since I was a kid. My parents didn't lean toward fundamentalism, but we went to a church that did. For instance, we didn't talk about dinosaurs in Sunday school, but we did at home. About the debate, I didn't watch it. I didn't see a need to. By 2014, I was probably considered an enemy of Ken's, and or even the Bible, since I had realized a few years earlier that it doesn't hecking matter to my faith as to how the earth and universe were formed. I had also started to see that maybe not everything in the Bible is literal. I mean, the word day in the start of Genesis can be understood to not mean a literal day. And there are other verses that say one of God's days is like 1,000 years. It's in one of the Psalms. I really don't remember where. But this just shows that the days in the beginning of Genesis are probably not literal. Back to Ken. This focus on how the universe was created seems to be the basis of Ken's faith. Instead of talking about all the things Jesus did, he talks about creationism. Ken has written many books, discussing topics from creationism, no surprise there, to racism. I kind of want to see what he has to say about that. It's probably bad. To why God allows bad things to happen, raising children, He has five of them. Evangelism, and a new 2021 book about the culture war. I bet this one is probably bad too. Frankly, they're probably all bad. In 2018, he wrote a book called Gospel Reset, Salvation Made Relevant. I found a copy of this book and took it home. And no, I didn't steal it. I found it in my church. It still sounds like I stole it. It's not a very large book. Praise the Lord. At the top left corner, there's a little blue rectangle with the words, A Gift from Answers in Genesis. And at the top right corner, there's a portion of a blurb from Ray Comfort. Fun story. I keep calling Ray Roy, and then everyone gets confused. Such is my life. I've even taken to calling him Ray Not Roy in hopes that it would help. But it hasn't. We'll come back to Ray in a moment. After flipping past the flyleaf of the book, we the readers get to see, from honest and entirely unbiased reviews, how amazing this book is. And I am going to read them to you now, and then talk about the men who gave the reviews. That's right, only men reviewed this book. And most are from the Southern Baptist Convention. First, we have a review by Dr. Brad Jerkovich, who is the senior pastor at First Baptist Church of Bossier City, Louisiana. He got his Bachelor's of Arts, his BA, from Southeastern Baptist Theological College in Biblical Studies, and his Master of Divinity, or MDiv, from Southeastern Baptist Theological Seminary, and his Doctor of Ministry, or DMIN, or Demon, which is really fun to say, because it sounds like demon. He got that degree from Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary. He writes, Ken Ham has provided an incredibly urgent, clear, and compelling resource that will help Christians everywhere to be strong in their faith and able to speak gospel truth in today's culture. As a pastor, I am very excited to have this book, as I know it will help our church in its mission to reach our generation for Christ. Second, we have a review by Robbie Gallaty, Ph.D., who is the pastor of Long Hollow Baptist Church in Hendersonville, Tennessee, and author of Growing Up and The Forgotten Jesus. He has an MDiv in expository preaching and a Ph.D. in preaching, both from New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary. He says, Western culture is consistently moving further and further from an understanding of the gospel of Jesus Christ. In large part, this is due to the fact that many do not have a foundational trust of the Bible. In Gospel Reset, Ken Ham builds the case for presenting the gospel from Genesis to reach this current generation. Every follower of Christ will benefit from reading this book. His phrase, presenting the gospel from Genesis, in the review gives us a huge hint of what to expect in Ken's book. Next is a review from Barry Cameron, who is the senior pastor at Crossroads Christian Church in Grand Prairie, Texas. His dad was also a pastor, and Barry and his wife have been debt-free since 2001. That is all I could find about what qualifies him to lead a church. Barry writes, The unchanging gospel of Jesus Christ is the hope of our ever-changing world. But what if our presentation of it keeps people from hearing it or responding to it? That's the premise of Ken Ham's new book. The majority of our young people leave the church when they leave home and never return. Why? Because they were never taught to defend their faith or how to deal with their doubts. Not sorry to interrupt here, but I think maybe young people stop going to church once they leave their parents' houses because... Oh, I don't know. The church treated them as objects, souls to be won, commodities, and if they or their friends didn't follow in line, they were vilified and ostracized. Or purity culture caused trauma. Or they were abused by people in the church, and that abuse was covered up by the church. And as to dealing with their doubts, there are so many churches that tell young people to never doubt. That it's sinful to doubt. They say something like, Well, boys and girls, if you have doubts, just shove them away and ask Jesus for forgiveness.
Back to Barry. What if we could change that? What if we could equip believers in every age and stage of life to boldly and effectively share the good news and stand up for the truth of God's word instead of standing down when the Bible is under attack? The church no longer has home field advantage in the world, but we can still win, and Ken Ham shows us how. The fourth review is from Dr. Johnny Hunt, now former pastor of First Baptist Church in Woodstock, Georgia, which, according to Wikipedia, is one of the largest churches in the United States. Hunt is also the former president of the Southern Baptist Convention. He currently is the senior vice president of evangelism and leadership at the North American Mission Board. He has a BA in religion from Gardner Webb College and an MDiv from Southeastern Baptist Theological Seminary. He has received several honorary doctorates over the years. He writes, "Things have changed, yes, even the world we live in. However, our message is unchanging, and Ken Ham gives clear, concise, and compelling hope to reach this changing world with the good news of Christ." We have two more reviews to go. Next is Dr. Ronnie Floyd. In Ken's book, he has Ronnie listed as a senior pastor of Cross Church in Northwest Arkansas and as the president of the National Day of Prayer Task Force. He no longer holds these positions. He resigned from being a pastor to become the president of the Southern Baptist Convention Executive Committee, and I think the National Day of Prayer Task Force thing ended when Trump's presidency ended. But I've had to come back and edit Ronnie's small portion in this video because I found out he resigned from the executive committee because he didn't want investigators to be able to review privileged legal memos and communications between committee officials and legal counsel, especially where it concerns the years of sexual abuse at the hands of SBC ministers and leadership. I have a couple of articles discussing Ronnie's resignation in my bibliography below. I'm not going to discuss all of the issues surrounding the SBC because I really don't know more than, / don't feel comfortable saying more than, they are handling this horribly, and my heart goes out to all of the survivors. I pray they get justice. Ronnie did seem to earn the title of doctor, having gotten his doctoral degree from Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary. I don't feel like talking about him anymore, so it's time to read his review.
When we understand the times, we will know what to do. This even includes the way that we communicate with other people. The Gospel Reset book by Ken Ham presents the enormous challenges we face today, but thankfully it also gives us practical ways we can communicate this gospel in a relevant way effectively. Anyone who desires to share Christ with other people or proclaim God's word in today's world needs to read this book. Get one for yourself, and then share another one with a friend. Finally, we come to Ray Comfort. Ray is from New Zealand, but lives in and is a citizen of the United States. According to his book, Nothing Created Everything, The Scientific Impossibility of Atheistic Evolution, that since Jesus, the first disciples, and the first 8,000 Christians were Jewish, that somehow means that he can call himself Jewish. And that is not how it works. That's not how any of that works. According to Ken Ham, Ray Comfort is an evangelist and the CEO of Living Waters. I couldn't find anything about Living Waters on Ray's Wikipedia page, so I decided to go to the source itself, only to be met with this. Good to know. I can comfortably say, see what I did there, that since Ray calls Ken his friend, that he's probably not a fun person to be around if you don't believe exactly the way he does. Ray says, "My friend Ken Ham is stubborn for the truth. He is a bulldog for the gospel. When he gets his Aussie teeth into something, he won't let it go. His message is uncompromising, compassionate, encouraging, and most timely. Please, read this book and pass it on to those you love." My first thought about Ray's review was something about the fruit of the Spirit. That is, this is how a Christian who is following Christ, God, the Holy Spirit, will act if they are allowing God to work in them and through them. The fruits of the Spirit are love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control.
Okay, so Ken Ham, according to Ray, is compassionate, but I don't know. I've never gotten that impression from the videos I've seen of him. Even when he's talking with other Christians. Some examples of Ken Ham's compassion. In 2010, Ken wrote a blog post which cited an article where Rachel Held Evans was interviewed and she talked about how she realized she could love Jesus and believe in evolution. He wrote in response, "Well, Rachel, I have news for you. Your generation is not ready to call a truce in this battle in the culture wars." Another example of Ken's compassion comes just a year later in 2011, when he was disinvited from several homeschooling conferences. At one of these conferences, which, if it wasn't obvious, are for Christian homeschoolers who teach Bible curricula, Ken discussed, as in criticized, the beliefs of the BioLogos Foundation, which states that God created the world using evolution. To quote from Ken's Wikipedia article, Ham accused Peter Enns, who was with the BioLogos Foundation and was a fellow speaker at the conference, of espousing outright liberal theology that totally undermines the authority of the Word of God. Ken then dug in and wrote Facebook and blog posts about Enns. This was followed by the disinvitations. Compassion. Does this come across as compassionate to you? Or does he come across as pretentious and a little combative? I guess we'll see how compassionate this book really is. Yes, I've talked for probably too long about not the book, but I really think this gives an accurate depiction of what we're getting ourselves into. Each pastor man who reviewed this book believes the Bible is inspired by God and is inerrant. That is, it doesn't have any mistakes and is totally true and trustworthy. Each of these men, as far as I can tell, do not believe women should be allowed as pastors or to teach men. They believe homosexuality is a sin. They believe marriage is defined by God as between a man and a woman, and I'm going to assume they mean cis people. If homosexuality is a sin, then trans people must be sinning by their very existence. Please note, I do not agree with any of that. Women, lead on. People who are LGBT plus, lead on, get married, exist. Note from the author. Not me, Ken Ham. It's about how Billy Graham passed away and how Fox News political commentator Tucker Carlson gave him a tribute. If that doesn't make your skin crawl, dot 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 dot. I knew I was in for a rough ride when I saw Tuck Tuck mentioned. I'm not going to say what other things I call Tucker, but I will say it rhymes with his name. The note also says that we live in a different country now. If another Billy Graham were to appear and do the same things the late Billy Graham did, the response wouldn't be the same. The problem, you see, is this dosh darn secularized culture. Okay, Ken doesn't say gosh darn in this book, but I bet he was thinking it. Forward by Bodie Hodge. Again, I just want to know a bit about who this guy is. He started working for AIG in 2003 after having worked for Caterpillar Incorporated as a test engineer. Bodie has a few degrees in mechanical engineering. He spent his years in college teaching middle and high schoolers biblical apologetics. For those who don't know, biblical apologetics is not apologizing. It's all about defending Christianity and/or the Bible against objections. I have never been into this. I believe God doesn't need defending, especially from me. And the Bible isn't perfect. It was written by people and translated by many more. If someone in that number didn't make a mistake, I will eat my hat. So now that we have an idea of who Bodie is, an associate or employee of Ken's, let's see what he has to say. The Western world, from North America to Europe to Australia, has changed. This is a common theme in fund evangelical circles. I notice they don't seem to care if the global south is changing, and I think it just goes to show they think the West is better. To continue the world has changed idea, my first 10 years or so were in the 90s. The early mid-90s seemed like a wonderful time. I didn't go to school. I was free to play all day. There was nothing wrong in the world. My view of the early 1990s is not accurate. I was a small child. I wasn't aware of what was happening in the world. I feel like it's the same sort of thing for people who long for ages past. They view the past either with rosy lenses or through young eyes. They view the past through a lens of privilege. They see women and BIPOC and LGBT plus people, all of whom have existed since the beginning of humanity, having voices and rights and power, and they think, the world is changing! And maybe it is. But is it really to the detriment of society? Or for the benefit? It's not like it was in the days of Billy Graham, when thousands just stood and listened to the gospel and responded. Evangelism in our culture today seems difficult and sometimes impossible. We preach Jesus, and people don't seem to care. Why? Allow me to explain, but first, permit me to preface it by discussing Latin America. Let's look at how the Western world has changed, but start with an example not in the Western world. I was on a trip to Peru speaking in churches and conferences and seeing some sights. At one point, one of our guides was leading a group of us Bible-believing Christians to see a whale graveyard in the desert. It was a long bus ride. Our guide had related that he was raised Catholic, but in speaking to him, I saw that he was heavily influenced by the religion of secular humanism. Secular humanism is the boogeyman of AIG. It's the belief that humanity is capable of morality and self-fulfillment without belief in God. Ken and AIG call it a religion. I'm not going to weigh judgment on that. I'm not sure if I would consider secular humanism to be a religion, and I don't trust Ken Ham to know what a religion is. If you believe secular humanism is a religion, I'd love to hear from you. For example, he professed millions of years and evolution. Whenever Ken and others at AIG say millions of years, what they're usually saying is people saying they believe the Earth to be millions of years old. Back to Bodhi. As we ventured out to the site of the whale fossils, our guide mentioned that these fossils were millions of years old. Our group kindly disagreed with him and said that we followed the Bible, because following the Bible means not believing in carbon dating. We believed the majority of fossils, including the whale fossils in question, were a result of the flood of Noah's day. How? Just how? I didn't know floods could kill whales? He seemed intrigued, and he asked us to clarify. We told him that the rock layers that the whales were in couldn't be both millions of years old and at the same time buried in the flood sediment. What if, and hear me out, the flood in Noah's lifetime didn't happen the way they think it did? Or even at all? I know, how heretical. But maybe whether or not the flood actually happened shouldn't, like creation, be the basis of our faith. I found an article, shared in the bibliography, in my description, from the National Center for Science Education that gives evidence that flooding in ancient southeastern Mesopotamia was not uncommon. And there are a few stories from that area that have floods. So we have Noah in the Bible, which is nearly identical to a story in the Quran. There's the epics of Gilgamesh and Atrahasis. Sorry for potential mispronunciations. Speaking clearly is not my strength. Was the whole earth flooded? Probably not. But their known world probably was, and at more than one point. We further elaborated that the rock layers were either formed in the flood or were laid down slowly over millions of years, with no major catastrophes, as the secularists teach. Our guide paused for a moment in thought. Then he said, God can't be wrong, so the idea of millions of years in the fossil record have to be wrong. He was incredibly relieved to know that he didn't have to believe in long ages and evolution anymore. It was like a switch just turned on for him, and it all made sense. I was actually shocked and unprepared for his response. I turned to the gents with me, because of course he only travels with men, who were fellow Christians who believed the Genesis account and said, "Well, that was easy." That happened. I realized he was raised to believe a global flood in his Catholic education, but at the same time he was taught millions of years and evolution. When this issue finally came to a head, he had enough of a foundation to realize that the Bible was true regarding the flood. Bring this back to our Western culture. I don't get responses like this. I mean, I'm assuming their guide in Peru was local, meaning he wasn't white. But does his lack of whiteness make him easier to convince? Because it feels like Bodhi is saying this. Tell me you're racist without telling me you're racist. I get people who are so ingrained with Big Bang, millions of years, and evolution that they are untouchable in their worldview. Sadly, this is even the case in many churches, Christian colleges, and seminaries, too. But the problem is worse than you may think. I've told people about Jesus, and I get responses like, Jesus who? I've told people that Jesus is the Son of God, and I get responses like, which God are you talking about? Zeus, Thor, Allah, or some other one? I've pointed out that people are sinners and need to be saved from their sin, and I've had people say, what is sin? If anyone watching slash listening to this who lives in the West and has never heard of Jesus or knows someone who, as an adult, has never heard of Jesus, let me know. No judgment. No trying to convert anyone to my beliefs. I'm just honestly curious how anyone in Western culture has never heard of Jesus. I realized that we are in a culture that has indeed changed. They no longer have the foundational information about God, His Word, and their need for salvation. Our culture, and even many within the church, have such a minute understanding of Scripture, particularly the early pages of Genesis, that they have little to no foundation to understand the message of Jesus. Again, early Genesis should not be the basis of one's Christian faith. And Jesus was not present in Genesis, regardless of what you may have read on Instagram. Unlike the foundation of our guide in Peru, many in our culture simply don't have any foundation to comprehend the message of Christ, ever since the Bible and Christianity have been kicked out of schools and replaced with the godless religion of secular humanism. That's not how this works. Not everyone is a Christian, and to expect everyone to be so is wrong. Way to be great with words, Nugget. The United States is not a theocracy. I went to public school and I'm still a Christian. Or at least, I call myself one. I doubt Ken believes I am. Indoctrination into religion should happen at your chosen place of worship and or at home, not at school. The sad part is that churches are largely doing business as usual, telling people about Jesus without the foundational knowledge of Christ. It isn't working like it used to in the West. How does that work, telling people about Jesus while at the same time not having knowledge about Christ? Spoiler alert, we will find out. But God didn't leave us in the dark. A careful analysis of Scripture and early missions work by the apostles Peter and Paul reveal the answer. Ken Ham dives into this subject brilliantly to teach churches and Christians how to evangelize and preach Christ in our culture today. What we need to share the truth of God's Word and Gospel of Jesus Christ in our changed Western world is a gospel reset. Oh hey, name of the book! Take a shot of your favorite beverage! And that, friends, brings us finally to the meat of the book. Introduction! I'm already exhausted. It's time to change it up. I won't be reading this whole book. No one needs that. I just hope you trust me enough to give an accurate representation of the book. If not, well, the book shouldn't be too hard to find at your local library. I don't recommend checking it out, though. Just read it in the library, flip through it, and see what you think, and then put it back on the shelf as if you'd never read it. So that being said, let's go. Ken starts the intro with a fun sentence. Something is happening in America. In fact, to the entire once Christianized Western world. What a doozy. He then spends a few sentences saying the Western world, Western culture, and even Western civilization is becoming less and less Christian and is decaying. How much you want to bet Ken likes Jordan Peterson? We already know he likes Tuck Tuck Carlson. It's not too far of a stretch. And those two men do seem to attract the same type of people, so make of that what you will. This is all supposition, of course. I have never met Ken, and I never want to. The phrase entire once Christianized Western world bothers me so much. So much. It goes along with the fixation that the West is best. Fun fact, there are many who agree that Western civilization is a code word slash euphemism for white supremacy. If your skin has crawled when you hear people like Jordan Peterson and now Ken Ham trying to keep Western civilization from being destroyed and you couldn't place your finger on why, this is it. It's white supremacy. I could go on and on about how historically, places that are now considered Western and once entirely Christian were filled with people who made up civilizations and followed religions that were not Christian. Enter colonialism and white supremacy, and then indigenous civilizations struggled to keep their languages and religions and ways of life intact. They struggled because white colonists killed many, and those they didn't kill, they forced to leave their culture behind. I could go on and on at great length about this, but I won't. For now. After Ken discusses the decline of white culture, he starts with some graphics, showing the readers just how much this decline is tearing apart the world. Or so he'd like us to think. First, he has a picture that's something like this. Now, if I were to make an image like this, I would not ignore all of what is known as the West. How rude is it to ignore Canada, New Zealand, and all of Europe? Especially since he mentions Europe by name before showing an image that is curiously missing Europe. Anyway, I would make something like this. The scary slasher type font really makes it apparent that this is a threat. Ken also includes a graph that, without numbers because I don't know how much research he did, that shows how the United States has the largest number of Christian institutions, churches and colleges, and the largest number of resources and media in the world. I didn't look into this, so I have no idea how true or false it is. We also don't know the scale. The bars on the graph could mean anything. To continue with more of Ken's words, as moral relativism enjoys greater national acceptance, Christians and their worldview are treated with increasing intolerance. There's a little thing which I'm sure many of you are familiar with called the paradox of tolerance. This, simply put, means a tolerant society cannot be tolerant of intolerance. See, if we as a society allow one group of people to hurt others, we aren't being a great society. If people aren't hurting others, let them be. Ken doesn't have to agree with them, but he can't try to infringe on their rights. Ken continues, "The elimination of prayer in the Bible from state schools was only the beginning." And I add to that, of realizing and accepting that not everyone is a Christian and that religion doesn't belong in schools the way it belongs in places of worship. What would Ken and the like do if they lived as white Christian fund evangelicals in, say, Dearborn, Michigan? If they were the minority in a largely Muslim area? If, by their possible logic, the majority can teach their religion in the public schools, wouldn't they feel uncomfortable having their kids learn Muslim prayers? They'd probably burn down the town and the school, just set fire to everything. Okay, maybe not literally, but you never know. This paragraph has more, saying that Christianity isn't welcome in other places, how people can't even practice their faith in public. There are a couple issues here. One, would they be okay with, like in the instances of the Ten Commandments, being in front of courthouses? Other religions having representations of their moral codes being there as well? I don't think they would. They don't want to make room for what they call pagan or satanic religions to exist alongside theirs. Two, when it comes to Christians practicing their faith in public, this usually involves harassing innocent people just trying to go about their lives. Furthermore, Ken and his like ignore that schools do cover the basics of the major religions around the world. I remember learning about them in my 8th grade social studies class. And they ignore that kids can start prayer groups and holy book study groups that take place in school. They're student-led and they take place in the school building. They can't force anyone to start or attend these groups, and maybe that's Ken's problem. Maybe he wants to force people. Can you imagine being a non-Christian teacher being forced to lead students of all faiths in a Christian-specific prayer? It just feels wrong to me. Almost sacrilegious. If parents want their kids to be indoctrinated in a religion, they can do it at home and at their place of worship. Even terminology, Ken writes, associated with Christian teaching is being changed or removed. For example, Merry Christmas is changed to Happy Holidays. Of course he would go there. Who called it? Again, he's not wanting to accept that other people who have other beliefs exist. Also, this paragraph had only that one example as to how Christian teaching is being changed/removed. Can anyone think of any other examples of this that doesn't involve Christmas? Maybe the Easter Bunny, but I know of many churches that don't shy away from the Easter Bunny, so I don't think it really counts. I think I found the thesis of this book with this sentence. We are not imparting the gospel in a way the next generation can grasp. Or the way I interpret it, the next generation doesn't understand the gospel. Of the people I know who are my age and are jaded with fund evangelicals, they grasp the gospel just fine. They leave the church because they aren't seeing the gospel enacted in those spaces. For instance, in 2019, a young woman posted a video she took while at church. She had gone to the bathroom during the service after performing in the praise and worship band. This video showed how an older woman followed her into the bathroom to harass and berate her for what she was wearing, even telling her to not go back on stage while dressed like that. Luckily, things turned out well, with the pastor and other leaders of the church supporting the young woman and removing her harasser from her voluntary positions. But this is just one example. Many don't turn out this well, and the young person leaves the church. There are countless examples of people who are LGBT+ being ostracized from their churches, and of young women being slut-shamed publicly. Don't even get me started on the churches that cover up all kinds of abuse. To repeat, it's not the gospel young people don't like or understand. They don't like the way people in churches can act. What we're seeing, Ken writes, is a divide in the West. You want to know what this divide is? You do. This divide is, wait for it, millennials! We sure do ruin everything, don't we? In the past, so I guess Gen X and before, apparently everyone thought like a Christian, even if they weren't a Christian, because Christianity was just so widespread. Then along came millennials and Gen Z, and we stopped thinking like Christians because we were secularized by culture and education. I guess this means we educated ourselves? Shouldn't past generations get some of this blame? According to Ken, all it takes is for Gen X and earlier generations to understand us younger generations, and then we'll be able to understand the gospel. Before you say, but millennials are all adults now, and Gen Z is well into entering adulthood, this book was written in 2018. So yeah, that checks out. The way Ken decides to bridge this divide is to think of himself as the Apostle Paul bringing the gospel to the Greeks. America, he writes, as a culture, in fact, the entire Western world, as in white people, used to be like Jews in this respect, as in, like the Apostle Peter preaching the gospel to fellow Jewish people. But that's no longer the case. Our culture, again, whiteness, has declined, having become more like the Greeks. He says the church has actually contributed to the lack of understanding of the Bible, that Sunday schools are teaching kids as if they are still in the same culture, but they aren't. But he'll talk more on that later. And so will I. I'm going to stop us here, since I want to not only give people a chance to process all they've heard today before hearing more, but also give myself a chance to recuperate. Much love to all of you! If you feel like it, you can find and read my sources below, and you can find me on Twitter at Nugget of Potato. See you next time!